richest lands and persecuted the Jews severely. And the Antichrist is coming, he is going to do the same thing even beyond what Antiochus did. Point number two, the profanity of the self-centered king. The profanity of the self-centered king. We're looking at Daniel chapter 11, verse 30 through to verse 34. In verse 30 of Daniel chapter 11, for the ships of cheating shall come against him. Therefore, he shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the holy covenant. I'm sure you understand when he's talking about the holy land, the pleasant land, the glorious land, and the holy covenant. He's talking about the children of Israel. He will have wrath, anger, indignation, and he'll want to fight against the people of God, that is, children of Israel. So shall he do. He shall even return and have intelligence with them, he'll have discussion with them, he'll have dialogue with them that forsake the holy covenant. What the Lord is saying here in the prophecy is that there'll be some backsliders, there'll be some apostates from the land of Israel. They will say, well, this Antiochus, that is when he comes eventually, is like a mighty person. Why are we going to be fighting and knocking our heads against the wall? And rather than resisting his evil, they will surrender and fall for his evil. And he'll have dialogue with them, he'll have understanding with them, he'll live with them, and he will have an agreement with them. And then he says in verse 31, an arm shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and shall take away the daily sacrifice, and they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate. In verse 32, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. That is of those children of Israel, the Jews, when Antiochus came, and then he saw that some of them already debated. They shifted from their roots, and they shifted from the holy covenant that God gave to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and to the children of Israel. He spotted them out, backsliders. They're like Judas Iscariot that the Pharisees and the Sadducees spotted out. And they knew that there's somebody in the midst of these 12 disciples that we can go through him. This one has debated. This one is a backslider. This one loves money more than he loves his master, more than he loves Jesus Christ. And therefore they could go through him. The Antichrist will do the same thing at the end of time. He look at the children of Israel, and he will see the people that are not faithful to the holy covenant. He will corrupt them with whatever it is, flatteries, and with his politics and policies and provision and prosperity and everything that he had to give. And it says, such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flatteries. But thank God, not everybody will fall. I said, not everybody will fall. Well, before I read on, if that will happen at the time of the Antichrist, at the time when things will be very difficult and very tough, and yet there are some tough-minded people, men of conviction, women of conviction, that will say, no matter the money, no matter the riches, no matter the wealth, no matter the politics, no matter the prosperity, and no matter whatever the Antichrist was willing to give, and they will say, we're going to stand, we will not compromise. If that will happen at that time, and not everybody will fall at this time now when the Antichrist has not come, will everybody fall? I said, will everybody fall? How about you? You will not fall. If God can help the people at that terrible time, and they will stand for righteousness, I'm believing God for you, I'm believing God with you. You will not fall. You will stand. Because you know the power of your God, and because you know the strength of our Savior, because you have the unction of the Holy Ghost within you, you have the promises of God, and because of that, no matter how many people are falling, you will stand and we will stand together in Jesus' name. And not only that, you know, as you think about the various denominations and churches and religious groups of the world, at near the time of the Antichrist coming, the Bible tells us that the word of God will not be very common. Many people go back into false doctrine. Many people go back into watered down preaching. Many people go back into just this superficial kind of watered down thing that will not hold any water, that will not bring righteousness to anybody's life. And you'll find this church has fallen away from the truth. That nomination has fallen away from the truth. That nomination has fallen away from the truth. And people will see. People will see. If all the major denominations and majority of denominations, they are falling away from the truth. They are thinking that it will soon come to our turn. We too will fall away from the truth. It will never come to our turn. Because if at the time of the Antichrist, at the time when it will manifest great, great, terrible wickedness and evil power, if there are some people that will still stand at this time now, this church, Deeper Life Bible Church, with you and with me here, and with us joining our hearts, our hands together, standing for the truth of the Word of God, content, honestly contending for the faith, once delivered unto the saints, as I look at you, I'm encouraged. And I know that we are standing together. I said we are standing together. You'll be praying with me, I'll be praying with you, and I believe that we're going to stand for this truth together in Jesus' name. It says, the love of many shall wax cold, but he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. I'm looking at people tonight who are going to stand till the end. We're going to stand for the truth till the end in Jesus' name. Come to verse 32. And such as do wickedly shall they, against the covenant, shall be covered by flatteries. But the people that do know their God. Are those people around? The people that do know their God. Where are they? God bless you. You are there. The Lord will set a mark upon you. And you will never fall in Jesus' name. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. In verse 33, and they that understand among the people shall instruct many, will teach other people, will instruct many people. And the Lord will use us to teach and transform many other people around us in Jesus' name. Then it says, yet shall they fall by the sword, and by the flame, and by captivity, and by spoil, many days. Now when they shall fall, that is, the Antichrist will fight against the people at that time, and many people will lose their lives. Don't be afraid, you'll not be here if you're a Christian. Because at the time of the rapture, which is before the great tribulation, we would have gone. I know I would have gone. We'll go together in Jesus' name. And it is after we have gone that the Antichrist will then be punishing the people and oppressing the people at the time of the great tribulation. Now, when they shall fall, they shall be holding with a little hair, but many shall cleave to them with flatteries. It's saying that those who are going to be caught in the web of that Antichrist, it will be because of the flatteries of the Antichrist. These verses were read in Daniel, that is verses 30 to 34. They're looking prophetically at two personalities to Daniel. One was to be in the near future, and the other was to be in the far future. To Daniel, one was to rise to power before the first coming of Christ. I'm sure you know the name of that one now. What's the name? Antiochus Epiphany. And then the other will rise to power just before the second coming of Christ. That's the Antichrist. The first one will be the fulfillment, which is Antiochus. And the other, the final future fulfillment, which will be the Antichrist. The Jewish history has put it on record that Antiochus had great indignation against the Holy Covenant, just like verse 30 prophesied, and did exactly as Daniel had prophesied. They shall pollute the sanctuary, verse 31, and they shall take away the daily sacrifice, verse 31, and they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate, still in verse 31. As we have read the history of the children of Israel, of the Jews, we have discovered exactly that was what happened. And Antiochus with his soldiers desecrated the Jewish temple, and then they sacrificed pigs, swine, so on their altar, and they even banned them from circumcising their male children, and they also stopped daily sacrifices. He actually imposed an idol statue in honor of the Olympian god Zeus into the temple, and that happened. We even have the date, December 15, 167 BC. That abomination of desolation caused the Jews to abandon the worship in their temple. That atrocity was only a preview of the abomination that would happen later under the final Antichrist. You know, Daniel has spoken about this before. Let's look at Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 27. Daniel said, that abomination is coming. And when that abomination comes, the people of Israel will not be able to worship in their temple anymore. Daniel chapter 9 verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to stop, to cease, to come to an end. For the overspreading of the abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Look at chapter 12 of Daniel, chapter 12 of Daniel, I'm reading there from verse 11. And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away. You see what Daniel is saying? He's saying that the time is coming in the future when the daily sacrifices of the children of Israel will be taken away. And it says from that time when the sacrifices shall be taken away and the abomination that maketh desolate settle. That is, the Antichrist, when he comes, he will set up the abomination. And that abomination will make the temple desolate. You know what that means? When he sacrifices like pigs, which is an unclean animal, upon their altar. And then he sprinkles the altar with the blood of that pig. And then he also puts an idol in that temple. And he eventually, as the Antichrist, sitting on the throne. Over there in the temple saying, I am God, there's no other God. The children of Israel will not visit that temple anymore. It's just the desolate. Nobody there anymore. That's what he's saying. And you know what Jesus Christ said? Jesus said that time is still coming in the future. That time has not happened yet. Look at Matthew chapter 24 verse 15. Matthew chapter 24. We're looking at verse 15. When you therefore shall see. Which means it has not happened. He was telling his own disciples that the church will still be on. And then the children of Israel of the future, when ye shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. Let's look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 4. And Paul is telling us the same thing, that this is still future. It's still coming. The time of the Antichrist. The time of the great tribulation. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 4. Who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God. He'll be blaspheming. He'll be saying, there's no other God, I am God. He'll sit in the temple and say, don't worship any other God, come and worship me. And when the children of Israel, when they see that, they will abandon that temple, because that is not the abomination of desolation. Who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God seated in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Revelation chapter 13. Revelation. We're looking at chapter 13 and we're looking at verse 5. Revelation chapter 13. We're looking at verse 5. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. That's 3.5 years. A time and times and happy time. 3.5 years, he'll be blaspheming. And he'll have power to continue for that long. In verse 11, it says, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had 2 horns like a lamb. And he spake as a dragon. Have you noticed that? Look at that verse 11 again. I don't want you to miss something there. I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And he has 2 horns like what? A lamb. Gentle and meek like a lamb. Peaceful like a lamb. Just nice like a lamb. Sheepish like a lamb. But then he spake as what? As a dragon. He'll come out eventually in his true colors, in his true personality. And then they become very wicked. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and causes the earth and they which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth what? Tell me out loud. He doeth great wonders. And that's what will deceive some religious people. The people that are looking for miracle at all costs, and they do not know that even Satan can appear to be doing miracle, but lying wonder, and that will deceive them. But thank God you will not be deceived. He doeth great wonders, so that he maketh the fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. And he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he hath power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they shall make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. Think about that. He had power to give what? Life to what? To the image of the beast. That is, he'll say, make a statue. And make that statue to look like the beast. The beast is representing the Antichrist. And he'll say, now look at that. That's just a statue, and you have seen that. And then he has the power to give the life unto that image. And when people see that, they say, and they say, have I not proved to you that I am God? Who else can give life to a statue? Who else can give life unto an image? And you say, that's why I sit in the temple. But some people, the Jewish people who know that the Antichrist is coming, they say, we are not going to be deceived by that. Miracles will not deceive us, and miracles will not deceive you. And that's why it says, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast shall both speak and cause as many as will not worship the image of the beast that he shall be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand and in their foreheads. I will not receive their mark. I said I will not receive their mark. Well, praise God, you will not be here at that time. We will not be here at that time. But if we know we are not going to be here at that time, why are we studying this? I'll show you 1 John chapter 2 verse 18. 1 John chapter 2, we're looking at verse 18. Little children, it is the last time. Little children, young people, believers, you know, John the Beloved was calling all the Christians, all the people, little children. You know why? He had known the Lord for many, many years. By this time, he wrote the epistle, General of John. He was already about 96 years of age. And he knew the Lord Jesus as personal Savior before the age of 20. He was virtually the youngest among all the disciples. And after spending 70 years with the Lord, all the other apostles had died. And he was the only living apostle at that time of the people that knew Jesus face to face. That's why he said, little children. So don't you think that he's talking to the children's church? Don't you think he's talking to only our teenagers and youth? He's even talking to me, the pastor, and he's talking to you, members and ministers of the church. Well, John the Beloved, we're all little children. Do you understand? So he's talking to us and says, little children, it is the last time. And as ye have heard that the Antichrist shall come, even now are there, tell me, many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. Even now, there are many Antichrists. And they are deceptive, they look nice, they look gentle, they flatter you. And as they flatter you, and then they want to present their false doctrine to you, if you are not careful, you'll say, this man is as gentle as our pastor. And it is even more gentle than our pastor, because sometimes our pastor says, sit down there, rise up there, and do this and do that. And this man doesn't do that. This one doesn't discipline anybody, does not rebuke anybody. I think, you know, our pastor should learn from this gentleman. I will never learn from an Antichrist. Praise the Lord. I'll follow Christ, but I'll not follow Antichrist. And you will follow Christ, you'll not follow Antichrist, in Jesus' name. There's the spirit of the Antichrist. And I pray that even though that spirit is in the world right now, the Lord will deliver you, deliver me, deliver us from their spirit, in Jesus' name. Look at 1 John chapter 4 verse 3. 1 John chapter 4 verse 3. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus is come in the flesh is not of God. This is that spirit of Antichrist. You see that? This is that spirit of Antichrist whereof ye have heard that it should come. And even now already is it in the world. Already now it is in the world. But can I show you something? Christ eventually will come. And Christ will destroy that Antichrist.